A very good morning to everyone. First of all, I'd like to thank our Almighty God for this program. I thank our management, SCAD Group of Institutions, and the higher officials of Francis Xavier Engineering College for their continuous support, motivation, and guidance for this webinar. Now, it's a time for prayer. Let's start this session with a prayer.
Prayer. Our Almighty God, we thank you for this webinar session. Lord, bless the participants with academic skills they require. Thank you for the desire that you have given the participants to join this session. Help each one to excel in their strengths and help them to gain more knowledge through this session. May your spirit guide us in all our endeavors. In Jesus' name, Amen.
Thank you, sir. I am Mrs. D. Angel N. Ranjithamani, heading the Department of Computer Applications. I extend a hearty welcome to all the participants from various colleges, industries, and FX Engineering College. I welcome you all for this webinar, Data Handling in Python, organized by the Department of Computer Applications, Francis Xavier Engineering College. It's a great privilege for me to introduce the resource person, Mrs. S. Jasmine Mary, Assistant Professor of MCA Department, FX Engineering College, who is a renowned person for her simplicity, dedication, and knowledge sharing. She has completed her UG degree in National College of Engineering, Marudakulam, and PG degree in Francis Xavier Engineering College, Tirunelveli. She is having 10 years teaching experience, and she has motivated and guided many students to explore their skills and talents in the field of information technology. She is having a vast knowledge in machine learning, Python programming, and deep learning, and also got certified. Her knowledge sharing is remarkable during her lecturing. It's a great thing to have such an eminent person among us as a resource person. Now I hand over the session to Mrs. S. Jasmine. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Unandal. And I welcome you all for this wonderful session on data handling in Python. And a very good morning to one and all gathered here. So we'll start the session on data handling using Python. So very good morning to one and all. And I hope all are fine by the grace of God in the amidst this lockdown. This webinar will be useful for both beginners and also for people already working in Python. First, let me give an introduction about the Python language. And Python is an open source and this is free to install. It is a popular programming language, and it was created by Guido Van Rossum and it was released in the year 1991. And it is an interpreted, object-oriented, high-level programming language with dynamic semantics, and it has built-in data structures, dynamic typing, and dynamic binding. It is simple to use. It is easy, and also the syntax are very easy to use. And it supports modules and packages. Now we'll see how to install a Python in installing Python in Windows operating system. So the basic website for installing Python will be the python.org website. And these are the two links for installing the basic versions. One of the version is 3.8.2, which is the latest version that is released by the Python. And it is available in the website python.org. It is an open source, so it is freely available, and you can also install 2.7.18 version also. It was released before this version 3.8.2. And how to work with Python, and you can use Jupyter notebooks to work with Python, and this Jupyter exists as an open source software, open standards and services for interactive computing for dozens of programming languages. And one of the main package we are using in Python is the pandas. and it is a fast, powerful, reliable, and easy to use open source data analysis and manipulation tool, which is built on top of the Python programming language. So we are using Jupyter Notebook for running the Python programs, and we are using Pandas package along with the Python programs. So how to run the Python programs? Either you can install the Python program from the python.org, since it's an open source, and you can install Jupyter, you can install the Pandas package, or directly you can run by from the Google Colab. And these are the steps for downloading the Google Colab. First, you have to download, search in Google helloworld.ipynb. Ipynb is the extension for the Python program. And save this Python program in the Google Drive. And under your mail ID, you have to save this file in the Google Drive. And then double click on the helloworld.ipynb from the Google Drive. It asks for a list of apps by which the file can be opened. And in the list of apps, you have to enable the Google Collaboratory. You can search Colab and you can enable the Google Collaboratory app to open the file. When you open the file, this is the screen, and the name of the file is displayed in the top of the screen, helloworld.ipynb. And by using the code, plus code, you can insert new code, and by using the run button, you can run the command. And this is the output for the command. This is very, very easy, similar to C and C++. Similar to C, it has a print command, which prints the text given along with the command. And by using the text option, you can modify the text. You can make the text as bold, you can make it as italic, you can make modifications to the text that is to be displayed. And when you choose file, new notebook, this is the page that is displayed, and it is displayed as untitled1.ipynb. And we can click on this untitled1, and you can rename it directly. It is not necessary to go directly to the file and choose the rename option. Directly you can click on the untitled, and you can change the name of the file. And these are the set of operations that can be done in Python. For example, the first option is addition of two numbers directly when you type. And the shortcut key for running command is Shift plus Enter. You can use the Shift plus Enter shortcut key to run the command. And this is the output we get for addition of 23 plus 35. Similarly, you can do addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division. And you can also import a package called as math. This package contains a sine function, and this sine function returns a value. And also this math.py, it's similar to the objects we use in C++. So math is an object and py is a variable. So we display the value of the variable py by using the dot operator. Similar, since Python is an object-oriented language, we use the dot operator to display the corresponding value. And these are the basic operations that can be done in Python. You can do addition, subtraction, multiplication, division. Mathematical functions, you can display the values, you can directly display the values, or you can assign variables to the values. For example, the first variable, variable 1, is assigned to 10, and when you use the type function to display the value, it displays the value of the variable is int. Second example, variable 2 is a string specified in double quotations, and we display the type of the variable 2, it displays string variable. And the third example, variable 3, is a complex number, and when you display the value of the type of the variable 3, it displays a complex number. And variable 4 is assigned to true. You can either assign true or false, and the type of the variable 4 is boolean. And the last example, last data type used in Python is bytes. Bytes value differs from the integer value by specifying a variable value B, start when you start the value B, then a single quotes you specify the value, then we, when you use the type function for the fifth variable, it displays bytes. And so totally we have integer, string, complex, boolean and bytes. These are the basic data structures we are using in Python. Then regarding the loops we are using, similar to C, C++, we have if loops, if else. And the one more main thing is you should specify the tags correctly. In the first example, we have num is equal to 2. If num mod 2 is the result is 0. This is the syntax. If num mod 2 is equal to 0 colon, then print the number percent i is even. Then the corresponding number for specifying the number, we specify it as percent i. The corresponding number is displayed as even. And this is the output for the above program, if program. And when you press, when you type if num mod 2 is equal to 0 colon, when you press colon and press enter, automatically tab will be specified for typing the next command. The second example using if is if else command, if else. And here we are getting a number as input. We are getting an integer number as input by using the int command and the input command. So when you specify int, you get an integer value as input. So when you run the program, a text box will be displayed. In the text box, you have to enter the value of the integer variable. And here, in the if here also, in the same if command, we check whether the number is, when divided by 0, returns, when divided by 2, returns 0. And if it returns 0, we display that the number is even. In the else condition, we display that the number, otherwise the number is odd. And these are the examples for loops, if condition and if else condition. And these are the outputs. The second example, we give the input 9 as, we give the value 9 as input. We give an integer value as input for the second program. And the output is displayed as the number 9 is odd. And other examples, we use for loops. And this is the syntax for for loops. And for, we specify the value in num colon. And by using this for loop, we display the values 2, 3, 4 and 5 in the first example. In the second example, we assign a variable even, and we specify a set of numbers. And for each number, we check if the value is, we can add a if condition. When you add the if condition, to check whether the values divide, when divided by 0, 2 returns 0, you can add the corresponding value to the even variable. The third example for for loop is by using the if else condition. Here we specify a variable called the salary, and we get the value of employee as input from the user. And we specify four employees, Tom, Jerry, Donald and Mickey. Four employees are specified. Then in the for loop, we check if the value is available in salary list. And if the input is equal to an employee, then display the corresponding salary. If the input is not available, then we display no such employee. In the second example, the first example, we give the input as Jerry, and Jerry's corresponding salary, 30,000, is displayed. And in the second example, we specify an employee who is not available in the list, and the employees, no such employee is displayed. And the functions that can be used in the Python language. So functions are defined by using the DEF keyword. And DEF is the keyword, and print a value is a function. And we specify a single argument in the function, and we define the function as to print the value is value. And when you call the function, it displays the value high as the value is high, and you can pass any value. Here in this example, you are passed a string value. You can pass either as integer, you can pass a single character, you can pass a complex number, or you can pass bytes also. Any data type can be passed along with the function, because we do not specify the data type along with the argument. We just specify the number of arguments along with the function. So when you call the function based on the arguments, the corresponding value is displayed. Instead of high, if you specify 10, then it will display in the output as the value is 10. So any data type can be passed along with the function. So print a value function is a user-defined function, and this is an example for single argument function. And the second example is a lambda function, and in this lambda function we use a function within function. We use two variables. This lambda function returns a value and it takes a single argument. So when you call this function by using x of 5, and the 5 is passed to the value of a, and the 5 plus 10 is displayed as 15, and we get the output as 15. So third example is x is equal to lambda a plus b colon a plus b plus 10. Here we use two variables. So when you call the x function, we have to pass two variables. 2 is passed to a, 5 is passed to the variable b. So when you get 2 plus 5 plus 10, you get 17 as output for the second function, third function. So the first user-defined function is print a value which contains a single argument. The second user-defined function is x. It contains an argument a. The third user-defined function contains two variables a and b. Then how to convert a given data series into a data frame. For example, already we saw pandas is a package, and you have to use the package similar to Java by using the import command. You use import pandas as pd. Pd is the variable that you are creating for the pandas package. And here we are assigning a data one value, and we are printing the data. This data will be in the form of a series data. And this data, series data, can be converted to a data frame by using this pandas variable. And you'll see an example for data frame. You'll see the definition for a data frame. How a data frame is being converted from a series data series to a data frame. And three different data structures are being used in Python. We use list, tuples, and dictionary. And list is separated by the square brackets. Tuples are separated by open and close brackets. And dictionary is created by using the curly braces. And this is the definition for list. A list is created by placing all the items inside square brackets. Tuple is created by placing items inside parentheses. Dictionary is created by placing inside the curly braces. And the main advantage of using dictionary is we can specify along with the curly braces a key value pair. Any number of keys and the corresponding value for the key can be created. And for a single key also, any number of values can be created. This is the advantage of using dictionary. And we'll see the example for each and every data structure. The first data structure is a list. And the first example, we are creating an empty list. So here already, as we see, by using hash, similar to C, hash can be used to specify a command. So we are creating an empty list with just the open and close brackets, and we are displaying the list. Either you can use print command, or directly the variable can be used to print the command. So when you use a variable, the corresponding empty list is displayed for list one. And in the second, list two, you are creating three variables, 1, 2, and 3, and we are displaying the list two variable. The three elements are displayed. So it is not necessary to create just integer values for a list. You can create any data type inside a list. So the first list three, you are creating the first value is a string variable. Second is a number. third is a complex number, and fourth is a boolean. And when you display list three, all the four values gets displayed. And when we use list zero, it is similar to an array. So in array, when you have five numbers, the index value starts from 0 to 4. So the first value is specified as 0 and the last value is specified as fourth value. And list 3 of 0 returns the first value web. And when you specify, when you use the type function to list the third entry, that is 0, 1, 2 and 3, which is true, the corresponding Boolean data type is returned as along with that type function. So you can also add any additional data to the list by using the append function. You can use and you can merge to list, you can concatenate to list, and you can create list within a list. Second data structure is a tuple. Already we saw tuple data structure is separated by a open and close brackets. And the first example, we are creating an empty tuple, and we are displaying the first tuple one. In the second tuple, similar to list, you can create any values of any data type. The first data type is integer, second is string, third is complex, and the fourth data type is a Boolean data type. And when we display the tuple, the values are displayed, and when you specify tuple of 2, similar to list, when you specify tuple of 2, the third value 0, 1 and 2, the complex number that gets displayed. And we are creating a third tuple with its Boolean value and a string value. And you can display, you can merge the two tuples by using the tuple 4. The fourth tuple merges tuple 2 and tuple 3. And tuple 2 contains 1, 2, 3, web 12 plus 23j false. Along with this, the tuple 3's value true and hello are displayed. And the main difference between this list and a tuple is, in the case of a list, it can replace a value. For example, if you want to replace list 3 of 3, you can replace true with false, but this replacement is not possible in tuple data structure. This is the main difference between tuples and list. So in list, you can replace a value, but this replacement is not possible in tuple data structure. Then the third data structure we're going to see is the dictionary data structure. Already we saw this dictionary data structure is separated by a key and a value pair. So the first example, we use four keys, 1, 2, 3, and 4. So for each and every key, we assign a value and we display the dictionary. And here also, when you use the key value for dictionary one, for dictionary one of two, the key value can be used to display the corresponding value. And we can display the keys by using the dot keys function. You can display the values by using the dot values function. And here, similar to list, we can replace a value. For example, in the key value, for the key value 3, the already available value is cat. And here you're replacing with another value, crow. And when you display the first dictionary 1, the first key value is as it is, second value is as it is, but the third value is replaced with from cat to crow. So here, in list, you can replace values. In tuples, you cannot replace values. And in dictionary also, you can replace values. Then, how to include the data files along with the Python program. For example, we are using, going to see a data file called as irisdata.csv. So CSV extension stands for the data files. These data files can be opened by using the Excel, Microsoft Excel. And for downloading the CSE file, you can choose google.com and type iris_data.csv, and you can freely download the data set and you can save it in your Google Drive. And then these are the commands by which you can import the corresponding data file into your program. First command is import pandas. You already saw this import command. It has to be imported. Second is you are importing a file from your drive to the Colab, Google Colab. Third, you are going to mount the file from the drive. Third, you are going to read the corresponding CSV file from the drive location. And the last command displays the corresponding data frame. And here we, by using the read CSV command, we create a data frame. The variable for the data frame is iris_df. And this is the definition for a data frame. A data frame is a two-dimensional data structure. That is, it contains a set of rows and a set of columns. And this, in the case of pandas data frame, it contains three principal components: the data, row, and columns. And this is how the screen looks when you execute the above four commands. You have to use it from google.colab.import drive, then drive.mount. So when you execute these two commands, it will be specified with an URL. And when you click the URL, it will be asked for a username and password. And you'll be getting an authorization code. And here you have entire authorization code. Along with this, a text box will be displayed. So you have to copy the authorization code and paste it in the text box. And when you paste, it'll be displayed as mounted at content drive. So it means that you can access files from the drive and you can use it in the Colab drive. And you can use it in the Google Colab. The second two commands, import pandas as pd. So here you are using a user defined variable iris_df, and you are using the variable pd. Pd is the variable which we created for the pandas package. So pd.read_csv, and we are specifying the location, your drive location, where you have saved the CSV file. And this will be the output. And this displays the iris_df data frame. And this data frame contains 150 columns and 150 rows and 5 columns. And these rows start from 0 to 149. And these are the actual columns present in the iris data set. We have sepal length, sepal width, petal length, petal width, and species. So the first four columns are of float data type, and the last column is of string data type. Second command, by using the head command in the data, how to use the head command in the data set. We use a defined variable iris_data_frame.head. It displays the first five rows present in the data frame. So the first five rows along with all the columns are displayed, and you can display any number of rows along with the head command. Either you can display one row, or you can display all the rows, or you can display, for example, the first six rows present in the data set. And here we display the data set starting from 0 to 5. Then the second command is the tail command, and this tail command displays the last five records. For example, we saw it starts from 0 to 149. So the last five records from 145 to 149 are displayed using the tail command. And here also is similar to the text command, head command. You can display last four rows alone, or you can display last two rows. You can choose user-defined values for displaying the number of rows. So the head command displays the first five rows, and the tail command displays the last five rows. And both these commands display all the columns present in the data set. And the next command is a drop. If you do not want any column, you can drop by using the species drop command. Here in this example, we are dropping the species column. So all the other columns, sepal length, width, petal length, petal width are available, but we do not have the species column. So by using the drop command, you can drop the corresponding column. And you have to specify, if you want to drop a column, you have to specify axis is equal to columns. And once we drop, these changes will not be saved, but just it will be displayed as output. And if you want to make a permanent change along with the draw, along with the data set, we have to use comma in place equal to true. If we specify in place equal to true, the data set will be displayed such that it drops the corresponding column species. So this command does, when you do not specify in place, this command just displays without the species column. Again, when you specify iris df in the next code, it will display along with the species column. So when you want to make a permanent change in the data set, you have to use the command in place equal to true. So default value for in place is false, and if you want permanent change, specify as in place is equal to true. The second command is the is null command. This returns either false or true value, and this is null function, if the value is not present, it returns a true. If the value is present, it returns a false. So for example, in this data set, for all the rows, the corresponding values are present. So the corresponding for zeroth row and sepal length, for all the rows value, it displays false, because there is no situation that there is value is not present. When the value is not present, it displays true. When the value is present, it displays false. So all the entries in this iris dataset returns false, because there is no null entry available in this data set. So it displays all the 150 rows and the 5 columns. The next example, we are using sum function along with the isNull function. So it displays all the column names, and it displays the number of entries which returns a null value. So in this example, iris data example, there is no entry such that it does not contain any value. So all the column values return a zero. Then the second command is the shape command. It displays the number of rows and the number of columns. And already we saw 150 rows and the 5 columns we had is sepal length, sepal width, petal length and petal width. And the last column is species. Along with the species command, the shape command is executed. Then the third, the last shape command is shape of zero. It returns the last row number. The row number for the last row is 150. So shape of zero returns a row number for the last row. And in this example, we have the last row is 150. And the next command is the info command. Info command is used along with the data frame iris, and this info command displays the data type for this, for each and every column. In this example, the range index is 150 entries starting from 0 to 149. Data columns are, there are totally 5 columns, and the first column sepal length, it contains 150 entries. And there is no null value, so it returns a non-null. And the data type for this column name sepal length is float. Similarly, for all the 4 column names, sepal length, sepal width, petal length, and petal width, the data type is float. And for the last, the data type is object. So totally 4 float data types and 1 object data type, and memory usage is just 6 KB. So we use a RAM. We already see we use a RAM. It stores temporary data in the RAM and permanent data in the disk. So the data space that is required for this data set is 6 KB. and this information command displays the number of rows, number of columns, then the column names, the number of entries in the column, whether it is null or non-null. It returns the data type for each and every column. Then at last it returns the number of data types, the number of columns which satisfy the specific data type. In this example, 4 columns specify float, 1 column per object, and the memory usage. These are the details that are displayed in the info command. So this sort underscore values is used to sort the values based on the ascending or descending order. For example, here we specify the simple width column for sorting the data. And if you do not specify the ascending value, it displays the sorted list in ascending order. Here we're specifying ascending equal to false. It means that the data is arranged in descending order. For example, here we use the column simple width. So simple width's maximum value is 4.4. This maximum value is displayed as the top of the row, and we have displayed all the entries in ascending order based on the simple width. And this is the main use of sort values. If the ascending variable is not specified, defaultly the values are sorted based on the in ascending order. And if we specify ascending equal to false, then the values are in the corresponding column are sorted based on in a descending order. Here we should use only integer or floating point for sorting the value. We cannot use any string value column. Here in this example, we have used the floating point column simple width for sorting the rows present in the iris data frame. The next example is location. LOC command, it displays the first value displays the rows and the second specifies the column. And here we're displaying rows from 100 to 115. And if you want to specify the columns alone, you can specify from 0 to 4 because we have only 5 columns here. Sepal length is the 0th column. And species is the 4th column. Totally, we have 5 columns starting from 0 to 4. And here we use only the row value to display the rows from 100 to 115. So totally, you have displayed 16 rows in this LOC command. The next command is similar to the LOC, ILOC command. And here by using the ILOC, we have colon, comma, minus 1. The first command displays the last column. Minus 1 specifies the last column, and if we have specified it as minus 2, it displays the row, it displays the column before the last, that is the petal width column will be displayed. Here we have displayed all the rows starting from 0 to 149, totally 150 rows we have displayed, and we have displayed the last column. And the second command is colon comma minus 3. Here we have displayed the third from the last column is the petal length. This column is displayed, petal length column is displayed, and the corresponding values are displayed. And the difference between this LOC command and the ILOC command. So this ILOC command also displays the data type, whereas LOC does not define the data type. Here we are defining the data type for the corresponding column. In the first example, for minus 1, the data type is object. For minus 3, the data type is float. And we are using 64-bit operating system. And this is the main difference between LOC and ILOC command. And in the LOC command, if we specify from 100 to 115, 100 to 115 number of rows will be displayed. But if in the ILOC command, if we specify 100 to 115, 100 to 114, that is the last before column rows only will be displayed. That is only 15 rows are displayed. Whereas in the case of the LOC command, we display 16 rows. Here we display only the 15 rows. This is the main difference between the LOC command and ILOC command. And all these commands are possible in LOC command also. You can specify colon comma minus 1 to display the last column. column comma minus t to display the third from the last column, that is a ptlent. All these commands are possible in the location command also, but the main difference is instead of displaying the last column 115 along with the output, it displays just the 114 commands. The next command is a median and the mean commands. I hope you all know about the difference between the median and mean values. Mean value defines average of the values, whereas median defines the midpoint of the values. So here in this example, for the given data frame, for the given column sepal length, we define the median. Median defines the, it returns the output as 5.8, which is the midpoint for this column sepal length. And this mean value defines the average, which is defined as a floating point as a 5.8433. And this is the main difference between median and mean. Median is the midpoint of the given set of values, and mean defines the average between the 150 columns. And these two values are different. Definitely, median and mean values are different. And the next command is a columns command. Dot columns specify the value of the columns. For example, sepal length, sepal width, petal length, petal width, species. And it returns the data type for the last column. And here in this example, totally we had 5 columns, sepal length, sepal width, petal length, petal width, species. And the data type for the last column species is returned as objects. And columns function defines the columns present in the data frame. And this is an example for a box plot for the column sepal length. And we plot the sepal length and we define the values for the column sepal length. And this box plot, it contains multiple variables. One of the variable is column. This variable, for this column variable, we have defined the sepal width as a column value. And we have defined the box plot, and it shows that the value the range between 2.5 and 3.5 is the high. Maximum number of values are in this range, 2.5 to 3.5, and many values contains the value 3.0 in this sepal width. And this is an example for a box plot for this column sepal width. And the second packages we are going to use is a matplot and the seaborn packages. And these are the commands for importing the packages. We use import matplotlibrary.pyplot as plt. This is the default variable that's being used in the pyplot package. And the second line is import seaborn as SNS. And this is the default variable we use for seaborn package. And the matplot is used to create a plotting graph. Seaborn is used to modify the plot we have created. And the third command, we specify the figure size to be 12,8. And we use a scatter plot. And in the scatter plot, the first is the x label, x is equal to sepal length. Second is the y label, y is equal to petal length. And we use a marker, asterisk symbol for as marker. And the data is the data, iris data we have created, iris the data frame. For the legend, we use species to specify the legend. There are three categories for species. For the three categories, it displays the comparison between the petal length and the sepal length. And here the next command is the title, comparison of sepal length and petal length. This title is displayed as the title for the graph. And the legends are displayed in the upper left corner of the graph. For example, the first blue color iris setosa species is displayed is in blue. Orange color displays iris versicula, and the green color displays iris virginia. So these legends are displayed in the upper left. The default position for displaying the legends in the graph is the upper left corner, and we display a scatter plot. Scatter plot contains x value, y value, and you can specify marker as any symbol, and you have to specify the data we use for marker. And based on the species value, we define the scatter plot, and we have displayed the title, and we have displayed the legend in the upper left corner of the graph. And in this, mainly we have used two packages, matplot library and seaborn package. The second type of graph is a density plot. Here we have displayed the title width column, and we have used the matplot library variable plt to specify the figure size, as first 12 specifies the row and 8 specifies the column. And we have set the set style as wide grid, and we use this to plot. This is the function used to display the density plot. Here the first value defines the column. The column we have used here is the people width, and we have used 20 bins, and you can use color as, yeah, here we used color as red. You can use blue or yellow, any colors, any combination of colors can be used to display the this density plot. And next example is a box plot. Box plot is available in this seaborn library, and we use the seaborn package variable SNS to display the box plot. The first command is figure size. We have specified as 12,8, and the style is set as wide grid. And in the box plot, the first variable we have specified the data frame variable. The second we are using BRBG palette color, and any combination of palette colors can be used for displaying this box plot. And the difference between the box plot available in along with the data frame and the box plot available with the seaborn library is, with the seaborn library we specify the data frame as a whole, and whatever the columns which contain integer or floating point values are used to display the box plot. Here four columns contain the floating point values: sepal length, sepal width, petal length, and petal width. All these four columns are displayed in the form of a box plot. And here, in the case of a box plot along with the data frame, we have used only a single column to display the box. And the next is the describe command. It describes a quantity of values, and here we display the mean value to count total number of rows. We have 150 for all the five columns. Mean value, describe command considers just the integer and the floating point columns. And the first row displays the count. Totally we have 150 rows. The second row displays the mean value of each and every column. Third displays the standard deviation. The fourth row displays the minimum value for all the column values, and 25% of the values display, 75% is displayed, and the last column displays the maximum value. That is, it just describes the whole table by using the describe function. It can count the number of rows, it can find the mean for each and every column, it can find standard deviation, minimum, maximum values, 25%, 50%, and 75%. So here 50% will be more or will be the median value. Okay, 50% will be the median value, and median value we already saw is just different from the mean value, and 50% we contain the median value. And the next command is a quantile command. It displays the quantile values of all the individual values. So it rounds off the value to the nearest quantile value. And the last command is a heat map command, and this heat map contains the first variable as irisdf.correl, C-O-R-R. C-O-R-R stands for correlation. So it defines a correlation between the variables. For example, in the first in the bottom of the row, first column, we have 0.82. It defines the relation between the first value petal width and sepal length. And the second value of variable available with heat map is the anode function, anode variable. This anode is set to true to display the values inside the individual square boxes. If you do not specify any anode value, no values are displayed inside the square brackets. And here, the darker color defines the lowest value and the lighter colors define highest value. For example, in the diagonal, we compare petal width with petal width. So the diagonal value is 1. For sepal length and sepal width, when you compare, the correlation will be definitely 1. So this correlation will be between minus 1 to plus 1. So here, consider the comparison between the sepal length and the sepal width. Value is 0.11. And here also you can, along with, after anode equal to true, you can specify the color range for displaying the heat map. So this heat map, by using the heat map, you can find the correlations between the values. So which is the highest value here? We have the highest value is 0.96. 0.96 is available in two columns. And this will define the relation between petal length and petal width, is 0.96. Here also, between petal length and petal width. So these two are highly related, and the smallest value is 0.11. 0.11 exists between sepal width and sepal length, and here this 0.11 also defines between sepal length and sepal width. And these values define the correlation between the columns. Thank you, one and all, present here. And I hope the session was useful for you. And you can post your queries in the chat box. And also, feedback form is available in the chat box. You can provide your feedback. You can provide a valuable feedback. And looking up for more sessions with you. Thank you.
Hope this session will be very useful for you all. I thank our Almighty God for the successful completion of this webinar. I thank our management, SCAT Group of Institutions, Professor P.N.D., Principal, for their support. I thank all the participants from various colleges and the participants from our college. I thank the resource person, Mrs. S. Jasmine Mary, for her valuable knowledge sharing. I thank Mr. A. Arul Amalraj for recording and materializing this live webinar. Thank you, sir. Finally, I thank all our departments.